thereof concerning what? The former conversation of all man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Verse 24 says, and that ye put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. Verse 25 goes on, wherefore putting away lying, speak every man truth with his neighbor, for we are members one another. Be ye angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath. Never give place to the devil. And it goes on, and it goes on, and it goes on. Brothers and sisters, oh, what I want to emphasize this morning is that you know that God has a plan for you. One of the reasons people don't want to come to church, they don't want to step into the church, they don't want to hear anything about God, is because somehow, someway, their minds have been tainted. Their brains like sponges have absorbed this idea, this pseudo thought that they're not good enough for Christ. They sponge this thought that nothing they can do can eradicate who they are, which is sinners. Yet, we know because Jesus shed the blood of Calvary, brothers and sisters, we can claim this. The day of salvation, the ransom has been paid.
He says, henceforth, walk not as the other Gentiles walk. Stop trying to follow people. We always follow people. We always believe someone else has the recipe to success.
Let me tell you what I've learned.
I've learned that idols become rivals. That's my short time. It's just when I say idols, people who look up to eventually become rivals.
Because then you find out what they know, they still working on what they know. What they teaching you, something, they still working on what you know. So you might as well look to God. Yeah. Why you want to take another man's opinion when God got in your opinion? Yeah. Why are you trying to take another man's rock? But he's still trying to figure it out. It don't make no sense to me.
That's why it says, the walk in which Gentiles walk. In the vanity of their mind, having the understanding of our minds, you have to understand, well, this is the crown of our minds. This is where salvation begins. It begins here. It begins here.
Let me tell you something. If you want to have a physical transformation goals, start that. Some of us, we won't wait until Jesus comes so we can have that complete physical transformation. Well, that's the easy route. But while we're here, physical transformation is always a worthy goal. Longevity, nonetheless, is required. But do you know that what you want to reflect on your physical appearance, you still have to somehow conjure it? If you can't see it, how are you going to obtain it? How are you going to achieve it? I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. How is that possible? Just because the words say so, or because I believe it in my mind, and I choose to make it so. Well, we're going to get there. We're getting there. What God wants us to do is to put a ring of blindness on our heart and recognize that He has a plan for us, a purpose for us, a unique one. Your DNA has God in it.
He wants to fill you up.
But if we keep filling ourselves up with each other and replacing what God wants to put there, then we will never reflect the true image of God and His God likeness. But thank you
for his grace and mercy. For this is the day of salvation. Brothers and sisters, give it to God, which man was and his name has been variously explored in detail. Men called experts, although scholars may differ on the nuances of the phrase, there is a general agreement that it has to do with dignity, destiny, and freedom. Stephen Peter. It has to do with dignity, we touched a little bit of the insecurities, destiny, and what? Freedom. First, the assertion that man is made in God's image shows each man his true dignity and worth. As God's image bearer, he merits infinite respect. Now I know when you were a child, you were taught some principles and values. It was in school, and it was the parents, somehow you came across those values. Treat others as you want to be treated. You've got to respect yourself and love yourself before you love and respect others. All this has to do with you. And a lot of us have not figured out that the reason why people, listen, are not in church is not because they don't know God. It's because they don't know that God's God. They don't know what 1 John says, that he loves me. We love him because he loved us first. They don't know that. Everyone is telling them something different. But it is our responsibility, brothers and sisters, to proclaim the gospel and talk about that true dignity, that respect, that infinite respect that God wants us to walk and carry. Keep your heads up. Shrug your shoulders. Walk the way God walks. You don't need to walk circumspectly with pride at the same time, right? That one really requires a little bonus. Because you know you have some folks in the church that walk circumspectly, and then some of us go around and we walk as lights.
When you learn to walk like Jesus, you just get it right.
You don't skip a beat, put a little bit in your step. There ain't nothing wrong with it, because you know Jesus. God claims on us must be taken with seriousness. No human being should ever be thought of as simply a cog in a machine or a mere means to an end. The other assertion points also to each man's true destiny. Our Maker so designed us that our nature finds final satisfaction and fulfillment only in a relationship of responsive godliness, which means precisely that state of correspondence between our acts and God's will, which we know, or which we call obedience. Destiny. You will never figure out, brothers and sisters, the destiny that God has for your life until you come into his likeness. Until you shadow his image. When you go and apply for a job, there's always some form of orientation or some form of internship. The focus is channel. I've seen guys who have had degrees and they have the theory, but they don't have the practice. The focus of orientation is a hush up, watch, listen, learn, follow. Correct? I've got some folks who are so opinionated, they let the degrees to get the best of them, and also for the sole purpose is the focus on the shadowing. They want to go and do the teaching. The problem is, we don't want to tell God where we should go, and what we should do, and how we should do it. We want to be the master. We want to be the teacher. And then we find out why we get that way. We find out why things go wrong. Oh, we say, oh, I never expected my life to turn out this way. Oh, how do I get here? Oh, Lord, please deliver me. You know, restoration is in destiny. Oh, Lord, restoration is in destiny. In order for you to get back on track, to take a detour and get back on the plan, you need the Holy Spirit to restore you. So there is restoration in destiny and in the plan that God has for your life. The last assertion confirms the genuineness of each man's freedom. Freedom. Experience would tell us that we are free in the sense that we make real choices between alternatives and could have chosen differently. And we all do agree. Self-determining freedom of choice is what sets God and his rational creatures apart from, let's just say, the birds and the bees. For we are born beings. When we focus on that legal foundation, what sets us differently is that freedom that we have to choose more to obtain the salvation and to begin and get a taste, I'm talking about a little bit of taste of what this meaning of covenant truly is. Covenant that God made between you and me began before the Garden of Eden, nonetheless, brothers and sisters, because he had to have a plan in order to make that covenant come up. So he was making covenants before we knew of God. Constantly redrafting on a way for you and I to inherit the kingdom of heaven. Somebody say amen. For the love of God. Full of treasure. Because what God is saying is that you still have the freedom to choose. You have to understand the difference between the birds, the bees, and the animals that he created was that he chose you specifically and designed you in his image in order that you could reflect him to enact the purpose he has in your life in order that only you can obtain salvation and be an instrument for it as well. That's what sets us apart from Jesus. We get to do two things. He only got to give salvation. He didn't need to be saved, remember. We get to be saved, and we also get to be used to save us. That's why it's a continual covenant. The one is a perpetual sign tonight. Because this covenant is never ending. It's non-stop. What God has promised you and me, he promised yesterday, today, and tomorrow. The promises that our spouses, our friends, our co-workers, our boss, our families, relatives, neighbors, whatever, whoever they made to us is not an eternal, perpetual promise. Only God can do it. God is saying, I want you to reflect me. Do as I do. Walk as I walk. Choose correctly. Do not allow the devil to distort your mind. The functioning organ that allows you and I to be recipients of this grace and mercy. Don't allow it to be tainted. Don't allow your dignity to be questioned whether or not you're worthy of God's salvation. Yes, you are. And you better tell everybody they're worthy too. See, I've
have understood. How is it that we can find a way to experience the gift of salvation and not yet want to share it? You cannot be saved if you don't want to be a part of the gift of salvation. You can't accept Jesus and not tell others about him. It makes no sense.
You can't say this covenant is for me only and it ain't for you. You don't have no fine print in your contract that I don't have to buy. We all have the fine print, brothers and sisters.
What an end. For a story of a young lady, somewhat like the Marshall's art. We have some of the Marshall's art to talk about. People that are with their dignity, their destiny, and their freedom to choose. This young lady preaches the Lord. This is a true story. It sounds like someone is going to be preaching the gift of the same. Oh, we have to pray for our pastor's children. If the devil came here, only that means coming out of the church. This girl had a gift, I tell you. She found a way to heal people to Christ with her. From there, crescendo of her voice. Daddy's little girl eventually venturing off to college decided to pick up an emphasis in performance arts, wanted to get into that glamorous life of singing, being on stage and being a superstar. Eventually came across people that saw how gift she had for the gift she did know she had. They saw something special. Their goal was not to use it. Their goal was to replace it. To change it into what their idea of special is. Brothers and sisters, young folks in here who are listening, no matter what track you take in life, you always have to have your principles and virtues with you close, because they will be put to question. And that freedom to choose what we call obedience will become, will be called to question. I tell you, this young lady was tried and tested, people telling her what she should do, how she should dress. Your skirts are too long, maybe a little bit short, they're too much tall, strip it up a little less, put makeup in and paint on your face because you're not beautiful enough. This young lady started to taint the very image of who God created her to be by becoming who some of what she should be. Eventually, they told her that she was overweight. You're just too heavy. So no matter what she did, no matter what exercises, transformative powers she tried to gather to change her physical appearance, she just was a big one. So that's where the drugs came in, and eventually using different substances to alter her appearance. Becoming addicted to drugs, codependent on alcohol, because she needed to fill a void, because people were stripping her dignity. No longer was she or feeling or felt, did she feel or felt like Daddy's little girl, but she felt like everybody's little girl. Slowly, years passed by, promises, oh, we're going to get you a deal, compromising along the way, nonetheless. You don't need to know all the details of the story, but slowly, slowly, the destiny that God had for her was slowly being stripped from her, like the very breath from her lungs. When she was at her lowest,
now tossed on the side, replaced with new young talents, younger, softer skin, longer hair, thinner appearance. So codependent on people telling her what to do, forgetting that God already had her. So focused on becoming who she thought she had to be when God already knew who she was. She fell into a pit of despair, just like the prodigal son, just like so many of our prodigal sons and daughters who give into the world and not give into Christ. Eventually ending up on the streets, soliciting herself to make ends meet. Until one day, her father could not take it anymore. A retired minister, having to go on the streets to look for his daughter and report him to rehab, to get on track. But brothers and sisters, this story doesn't end with us. Because this is one where the daughter of the minister loses her life, constantly struggling back and forth with her destiny, her dignity, and her freedom. All because she forgot she was an image and a reflection of Christ. She focused on becoming a mere reflection of the world, and the world sucked her. Brothers and sisters, I know it's not easy. I know we don't always make the right choices. And I know when we wake up, we don't always illumine. And the confidence of God does not always express upon us. But it is our freedom to obey God's will, to choose to want to set ourselves apart and be holy that allows us to share in this covenant. Here's the deal. It takes two to tango. When you make a covenant with God, He has already made it with you. In order for it to be complete, you have to believe that you are the image of God, that you will fill up for a purpose. And that nothing can come between you and the city. Brothers and sisters, God has a plan for you. Amen. He created them and He created you and He created me for us. That purpose is first to accept Him as your Lord and Savior. To become a representation and a mere shadow of His image. And to go on His errand and become an instrument for salvation. There's no greater pride. There's no greater joy than to love, to serve, and to worship the Most High. Brothers and sisters, I don't know about you, but I want to portray the image of God. Every day He gives me life, every day I wake up, even when I feel down and gloomy, depressed, I got nothing left in me. I almost let go, but God said, no, I'm not done. Shower me up. He says, no, I'm not done. But He will fill us up. He will fill us up today. If it is your desire today to be filled up with the power of God, then all we can reflect in to begin to continue this covenant, this act made with Him. This is your desire when you stand on your feet. Your desire is to reflect the image of God. You know, to each his own, when I say that, we interpret it differently. But what I would love to know, God really loves, is that you do not misinterpret the plan He has for you. Don't let anyone, anything tell you different. Your reputation is linked to His infinite respect. Keep your hands up, hold your hands up. You're worthy of this word. You're worthy of this strength. Tainted and marred and scorched. ways beyond explanation. And no one here needs to know your past, present, or future.
You've been shadowing everything but Christ, and you know that God is speaking to you. You don't know how, you don't know when, but you know He wants to do it again. He wants to continue where He started with you and transform you. There's someone here who's been struggling in the world. The world has been pressuring them to be this and do that. But you want to be that man, that woman for Christ. You want to make a change, brothers and sisters. And someone here, their desire is to begin today to receive that new image, to reflect that image of God. And they're very glad. You know that you need a more powerful prayer. You need to come closer to the foot of the cross. This appeal goes to you this afternoon. You want the power of God to move in you in such a way that when you call out His name, when you wake up in the morning, you don't have to look in the mirror. You know it. You reflect Christ. You don't have to worry about the other things. Someone here doesn't want to know or worry about the other things. We come forward. We want to pray for you. We want to pray for you because God wants to work in you today, tomorrow, every day in His life. He wants to encourage you to come out more and absorb this covenant, this meaning of what it is to have a covenant. It's your desire when you come. God bless you, Lord. Is there a God? Is there a God? Will you bow your heads as we pray? Lord Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity that you have given us to receive your consciousness of my life. The opportunity you grant us to be recipients of your grace. Oh Heavenly Father, thank you for reminding us once more that we have a purpose. Our destiny is sure that we can lift our heads high as children of the Most High, knowingly that we reflect you. So we are ambassadors of Christ. Oh Heavenly Father, forgive us of our sins, our doubts, our failures, our shortcomings, and we've disrupted that transformation that you tried to begin. But we ask to come on in and continue it. Allow it to reside, make it perpetual, to resonate deep, that it can have transformation not only within, but it begins to reflect without. That people can see that we are like bearers of Jesus Christ. Let us be image bearers as well. Oh, thank you for your Holy Spirit that allows us to be filled up. Oh, thank you, Heavenly Father, that you've given us the opportunity to have that freedom not only to choose, but instructions from your word. We can read your word freely in order that we can go ahead and choose freely. We don't take that for granted. Oh Heavenly Father, we thank you for the word today. Let the people hear you, see you, and want to change with you and in you. As they leave here, dear God, allow your Holy Spirit to bring them back here, to come out and receive more of this power, more of this understanding, what it is to have a covenant. Bless us, Heavenly Father. Bless every family represented. We ask that you will use it, who will discourage, take to destroy, or you will try to kill and destroy those who want to know how they can bind themselves closer to you. Oh, put a safe hedge around us all. The friends, families, neighbors, co-workers, those we plan to invite
in order that they too can experience this gift, dear God, allowing the power and presence to go forth. You do the work. Let's show up. And then at the end of the day, we can all say, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Let all God's people say, amen.
This is all in Christ.